also seen how to launch this kernel function. We have seen what are the built-in variables, dim block, block index, and whatever thread index variables. And then we have seen how this thread organization can be done, how this dim block and grid dim, these all these things can be organized. We have seen that this dim grid and dim block are the dim three type of variables where we assign the values for dot x, I mean horizontal direction, x direction, y direction, as well as z direction. And then we were able to understand that the matrices that are being saved, they are in row measure order. So now you have already done some assignments on performing some operation on a pixel of on each pixel of image. While doing this, I don't know you have used synchronization or not, but we have read what synchronization was and other things. So now today that we are going to read is this thing, CUDA memories. Basically, we have seen that there are whatever till now we have stored in memory, we have used global memory, right? This is just an example, don't worry about it. The only thing that we have to see it was the for loop. What I want to show here is if we have a for loop inside a kernel function, what will happen? What will happen is for each operation, for each iteration, I should say, for each iteration here in this loop, if you see, you have two global memory access here, one for DM and another for DN, as well as you have two operation, one is here multiplication between these two things, and one is addition of earlier value to the result. So now one thing that we can understand is by effective access of memory, or if we want to improve the efficiency of our memory access, we must be able to access, we must be able to decrease the number of memory access, that is we want to say, at least the global memory access. So one thing that we can calculate is compute to global memory access ratio. We call it CGMA ratio. This is the ratio of how many compute operations are performed to how many global memory accesses are there. So in this case, if you see here, you have two global memory access as well as two compute operation. In that case, it can be called as 1-to-1 ratio. So by this ratio, we just try to understand how good our, how efficient, I should say, how efficient our memory access is. The thing is, we should have less number of memory access, as less as possible. So now we are ready to see what are the CUDA device memory types. Actually, here you can see the CUDA device memories. This is global memory, constant memory. Now, these memories, global memory and constant memory. Okay. They can be written or read, from the host side using some API functions. You already know that API function. We call it CUDA MEMS API, So the constant memory actually supports spot latency, high bandwidth, and read-only access by the device. Actually, constant memory can be treated as a part of global memory, but it is faster. Okay, I should say it is cached. Okay, so that is the thing. Now here, as far as registers and shared memory are concerned, you can see registers and shared memory are on-chip memory. Registers and shared memory are on-chip memory. So variables that reside in these memories can be accessed at very high speed in a highly parallel manner. That is okay. So per thread, you are having some register, and per block you are having some shared memory. Okay, per block means per SM. That's it. So here you have a hierarchy of memory where there is register, shared memory, global and constant memory. So each thread will have separate registers. Shared memory will be accessed between all the threads in a block, and global memory, constant memory will be accessed to all the threads in the application. Okay. Next. So this is a simple computer architecture, I should say, von Neumann architecture means architecture of modern computer, right? So here basically we are trying to see the memory and register, that if you want to perform some operation, maybe it is add operation, and what is the difference when the data, your operands, I should say, these operands are in the register file and when the operands are in memory. Let us assume the data is already in the register. Okay. In that case, what will happen? Here R2 and R3. In these registers, they specify the location in the register file where the input operand values can be found. So the ALU can fastly access the, means ALU perform, means the operands can be fastly accessed and the operation can be performed and the result can be stored in this R1. Now in case one of the operands, say R2, if at all it was in memory. So before operating in ALU, before this add instruction, we will have to load the data. So if we will have to load the data, it will take some time. So what they are saying is memory is something like DRAM, which is of low long access latency and low bandwidth. However, the registers are fast, as well as bandwidth is also high. This was the case of our modern computer based on von Neumann architecture. However, if you are dealing with means energy efficient also, if at all less resistors. If we use resistors, they are energy efficient also. Faster also. These are 2 points. Okay. Now, if we talk about the CUDA shared memory, here in CUDA shared memory, what happens here in CUDA streaming multiprocessor? You can see here different. Yes, these are the processing units are there. Each processing unit will have ALU as well as a register file. However, there is a shared memory which is being accessed by all these processing units. So basically what happens, we understand that there is a program counter, instruction register, how this instruction is fetched from the memory and is stored to here in instruction register, and this instruction register will be used by all these processing units, and the data will be required. Now this data can be accessed from shared memory or from global memory or from the register. So the only thing is register is faster, right? And the registers are separate. I should say we have separate registers, register file for each processing unit. However, shared memory is accessed by all the processing units. So here it is saying shared memory is a form of scratchpad memory. I believe if you will have any confusion, you will keep asking questions. So here a few important things is the variables that reside in the shared memory are accessible to all the threads, and register data are private to a thread. Shared memory is designed to support efficient high bandwidth sharing of data among the threads in a block. Yeah. Now, the thing is, how can we declare these kind of variables? Either we want a variable in register to be stored in register, to be stored in local memories, or in shared memory, or global memory, or constant memory kind of. So let me tell you, the first thing is, if you want to have a variable in register, they will be called as automatic variables. Until now, in a kernel function, if you use, if you declare any variable in a kernel function like int I, int idx, int something, means kind of any variable that you will declare there, they are stored in register. Okay, they are automatically. So if you are declaring some variable inside the kernel, there will be separate variables for each thread, okay, and they will be there till this thread is executing or this kernel is alive. Once this thread completes its execution, these automatic variables are no longer available. Now the other thing is automatic array, okay, automatic array variable. In this automatic array variable, actually they are not stored in registers, okay, they are stored in global memory. Actually what book suggested is we seldom use these kind of automatic variables, automatic array variables. But however, if we want to use these automatic array variables, they will have long access delays, means the access delays of global memory. So if we really need this kind of automatic array, we can use, they will be declared in, if you declare some variable inside a kernel, this, if at all it is an array, it will be stored in global memory. You have to understand. The other thing is, if you want to have some shared memory, if you want to declare variable in shared memory, what you are going to do is, you will just use this __shared__ in front of the variable declaration. So definitely you can use __device in front of this. It has the same effect. Okay. So such declaration typically resides within a kernel function or a device function. If you have declared some device function there also, means in those device function you can declare such shared variable. So these shared variables reside in shared memory, no problem. You can see here the scope and lifetime. Scope is block, till all the threads are alive in the block. Lifetime is kernel. Okay, till means all the threads in the block can access this variable, as well as till the kernel is alive, this variable is it. Similarly, if you are writing just __device__ and the variable, this is possible, you can do it, but the thing is, you will not do it inside any function. Now this is a global memory, so you will do it outside the function. So you will define, you can define a global memory like this. So it is a global memory until the application is available, until application is running, this variable is accessible to all the threads in the application. Similar is something called constant variable, which is __ constant. So this will be a variable available in constant memory, and it will be available for all the threads until the application is running. So these constant variables are often used for variables that provide input values to the kernel functions. These constant variables are actually fast, means they are stored in the global memory but are cached for efficient access. So there is somebody whose mic is gone. Okay. So I was telling you that there is a constant memory, but there is a limitation of this constant memory, how much size can be. I mean, it is just 65,536 bytes only. That is what we have to understand. Let me repeat, 65,536. So this is something about the variables. This is how you can declare the variable. If I will tell you about the pointers, okay. What is this? You can use the global memory, but you should understand that there is no way of synchronization till now for this global memory access. So we will have to program on ourselves for synchronizing. Maybe multiple threads are accessing the memory at the same time, and if they are trying to write the data, then need some kind of synchronization. Okay. Now, if you talk about the pointers, you have already seen how to declare the pointers. Here I am telling you there are two methods, from which the first method you have already used. It was creating a pointer to the object. by writing the by using this CUDA MLOC function. Now the second way can also be like you can declare a variable earlier, maybe global variable or whatever, and then you can assign the address of this global variable to a pointer variable. That is also possible. These are the two methods that you can use.